One of my favorite things in the world to do is watch Friends. I know it's been off for years and years. It's not even around, but I still find myself binge watching old episodes. And I was thinking about this today and thinking, it's the predictability of the friends in the circle, right? You have Chandler with his quirkiness, Monica with her type A of just everything has to be so neat and tidy and organized. It's Phoebe's ability to make you laugh at her silly songs. Ross always comes in with those smart comments, and Joey and him and his food, like it is just so hilarious. And of course, Rachel, she just brings everybody together. And it's just such this beautiful, cohesive team of people. And it's why I wanted to come on and share with you today that I have an opportunity for you to find your friends in the content creation space. So if you are thinking about creating your first or your next digital course, I don't want you to miss this opportunity because Amy Porterfield just opened the doors for registration for her Course Confident Bootcamp. And I'm actually offering a special bonus for anyone that registers for the Course Confident Bootcamp through my special link. So I want you to go to crystalprofit.com/Amy-bootcamp to register. That's crystalprofit.com/Amy-bootcamp. And what you're going to find when you get there is I have this special bonus private podcast series. It's called Money Mindset for Creators. So I want you to go register for Amy's bootcamp, download the podcast, and immediately start listening to it, because what this training is set up to do is to help you get your mind right about monetizing your content, making money so that you can fuel your content creation dreams. So go to crystalprofit.com/Amy-bootcamp to register for Course Confident. And I cannot wait for you to find your friends and find the people that will be there for you. Do you see what I did there? Yeah. Nice little friends segue connection. Go to crystalprofit.com/Amy-bootcamp. And I cannot wait to see you inside. Okay. Let's get into today's episode. All right, Profit Podcast listeners, y'all know that I love trying new things, right? I mean, this podcast would not be here if I just didn't have the confidence, we'll just call it that, to go out and try new things. And then I come back, I report back to you, right? I feel like you're my manager. And I'm just like out there, I'm grinding, I'm doing the things. And then every once in a while, I'm like, oh, I gotta go report back because I tried this thing out. Here's how it worked. Here's how it didn't work. And I just need to report back and tell you, don't do this or do this again or try this out. So that's what we're doing today. We're actually doing a two-part episode because I'm like, we couldn't fit all this into one. If we did, it would be like forever long. And you know, I like to keep things kind of short. I don't like to go hours and hours for a single podcast episode. So what I'm doing is I'm breaking up the topic of podcast websites over the next two episodes. So episode 263 and then episode 264, whenever it comes out, they're going to be about creating amazing podcast websites. So let's get right to it. Welcome to the Profit Podcast, where we teach entrepreneurs how to start, launch, and market their podcast. I'm your host, Krystal Profit, and I'm so excited that you're here. Thanks for hanging out with me today, because if you've been trying to figure out the world of podcasting, think of this show as the time-saving shortcut you've been looking for. So let's get right to it, shall we? Okay, so in the beginning, like I said, we are starting we'll call it a mini-series, right? We're going to do part one today, and then on the next episode, we're going to talk about part two of creating your podcast website. So there's another reason why I wanted to split this up over two episodes, and that's because today we're going to talk about the basics of podcast websites, mostly for beginners and brand new people. And then in the next episode, we're going to talk about people that may be a little bit more seasoned or those of you that are looking for ideas on how to level up. So this is another reason why I was like, if I throw everything into one episode, I just don't feel like it's going to hit as well. So like I said, we're constantly experimenting. I don't typically stretch out an idea over two episodes, but you know what? Like I have told y'all this so many times. It's my podcast. I make the rules and I want you to have the same thought for your show as well. So there are no rules when it comes to podcasting, guys. We have a lot of guidelines and we have a lot of suggested things, but don't think that just because you start your podcast one way that it's set in stone and you can't change things up and have a little fun from time to time. So first and foremost, everything we're going to talk about today can be found in the show notes. So that is krystalprofit.com/episode 263. That's where you're going to find, I'm going to link to a few podcast episodes that we already have and some other really cool resources that I do not want you to miss. Okay. So I wanted to start today's episode. I'm laughing because I'm a little embarrassed with the story I'm about to tell you, but it has to be said. So I cannot talk about podcast websites without telling you about my very first experience creating a website. So a few years ago, we're talking 2014, 2015, we lived in a really small town in East Texas. It actually wasn't too far from my hometown. So if you've ever heard the podcast and you're like, where's Krystal exactly from? Where's this accent coming from? I was born and raised in Athens, Texas. Yes, it's an actual place, not Athens, Greece. Whenever I tell people like, oh, I'm from Athens, they're like, Greece? And I'm like, really? That's your first thought when you hear this accent? Is that girl's from Athens, Greece? No. Maybe Athens, Georgia, because they got the twang too. But no, Athens, Texas is my hometown. And we had an opportunity to live in the East Texas area again. We were in a small town called Bullard. So shout out all my Bullard, Texas peeps. Like I know there's like two of y'all. It's so small. It is such a small community. And while we were there, I was a stay-at-home mom. This was like the very, very early days of my journey as being a stay-at-home mom and exploring what I wanted to do with my time. And I started writing a lot. And I also started taking the kids to the library, because if anybody's been at home with kids for a long time, the question you're always asking yourself is, when can I see adults? When can I see other people? And it was typically at story time at the library every single week. I would just be like, come on, kids, load up the minivan. We are all going to the library for story time, right? Like, quote unquote, it was for the kids, but really it was so mama had some other adult interaction. Let's just be real. If you've been at home for any amount of time with small children and you're just looking around, like, I will talk to the mailman, I will talk to anybody. Yeah, that's the place of desperation that I was at. So we hung out a lot at our little community library. And it's important to know that this library was not state funded. It was not funded by the city. It wasn't funded by the county. Like, they basically were a community run library. So their funds were minimal. And when I say minimal, I'm talking about it was the building next to the donut shop that looked like it was about to fall apart. And you're like, oh, wait, that's a library? Like, you just had no idea. So whenever I started hanging out there, I got to know the director and the head librarian, and we were chatting, and I just felt the need to offer up my services, which is funny because I'm like, I didn't have any services, but I'd say, hey, is there anything I can do to help y'all around here? You know, I have the kids and everything, but you know, if you have anything, I'd be happy to help y'all. And the director said, you know what? We are trying to redo our website. Do you have any experience doing that? And I thought, no, but I don't know. Like, I don't, like, that's not my thing. I don't know how to code. I don't know any of that fancy, like, web language, like, developer. Like, I don't do any of that. Like, that's not my thing. And then they basically said, well, you can't make it look any worse than it looks right now. So I went from having all this self-doubt to all of a sudden being like, Okay, like that was a boost of confidence. Like, I can't break it, right? I'm not going to break the internet if I try to do this website. So long story short, I didn't build because it wasn't from scratch, right? They already had something there, but I kind of helped them incorporate new images and some new navigation and just doing some new things with their website library. And that little baby step was a boost of confidence. So whenever I actually went to create my own website, I kind of knew what I was doing and was able to do my own thing. I didn't have to hire this out to a developer. And it was kind of fun to be able to play on their platform. Again, knowing that I couldn't make it any worse than it already was. Those are their words, okay? I don't want to say that's my words. That was their language of how they spoke about their website, and they were pretty happy with it whenever I was done. But it was nice to not have the pressure of like, oh my gosh, I have to invest all this money to figure out how to do this. What if it doesn't work? What if I end up wasting money? I didn't have any of that because it wasn't for me. It was for them. It was for me to help them. And coming from that place of service just really motivated me to get it done and to do a good job. So that was my first website experience. And then, I mean, here we are 5-6 years later, and I have learned so much about websites. Oh my gosh, so much, from hosting your own website with WordPress to having one on Kajabi to creating one in Weebly. Like, I have learned so many different things. Now, to be clear, I am still not a developer. I don't code a bunch of things. I don't do a lot of really fancy things with my website. But what you see on crystalprofit.com and on Profit Podcasting, which is where I host my courses and my products, I've developed those. I've had some help from copywriters and other people that have helped me develop some of it. But I mean, 80 to 90% of it was me, like, in the background writing things and doing things. So I have some experience in doing websites, and I want you to have more confidence that your podcast can have a website. Okay, because I get this question a lot is, do I actually need a podcast website if I'm just getting started?
Being a woman in business comes with its own unique set of challenges, but also so many opportunities. We get ahead by leaning in to what makes us different from business as usual. I'm Samantha Hartley, host of Profitable Joyful Consulting, inviting you to a special 6-episode series exploring the experience of being a woman in business. You want to hear from women consultants who've hit $1 million, who sell 6-figure engagements, or who've broken their own revenue ceilings? Yeah, those are my clients, and they'll be sharing too. Join me for 6 must-listen episodes that tackle key challenges for women consultants. Follow Profitable Joyful Consulting on your favorite podcast app.
My answer is always going to be yes, but it depends on your situation. Because believe it or not, there's not just one way to have a website. There are so many different ways that you can have a website. And actually, there is a product that is for sale right now, like as we're recording this, as this airs, that is me teaching you how to create a podcast website that listeners actually want to visit. And this is part of the BC Stack promotion that happens once a year. So I'm not going to make like a whole sales pitch about what we're going to do. You probably heard an ad for it whenever you're listening to this. But if you go to crystalprofit.com/BC Stack 21, you can learn more about this. And I'm going to go into detail. It's going to be a live training, and it's going to be very much in depth. So if you like what you hear in today's episode and in the next episode, then it could be something for you. But it only comes around once a year, and it's from June 13th through June 18th, 2021. So if you're listening to this, I hope you stick around and listen to more about podcast websites. But I did want to like give a shameless plug for this masterclass training because it's going to be incredible. And y'all, BC Stack is $47. I'm not trying to sell you, you know, a $10,000 product. It's $47. It's less than $50 And the product that I'm creating alone is valued at over $100. So I definitely want you to go check it out. But I want to talk about why your podcast needs a website. That's really what I wanted to hone in on today. So the obvious reason why your podcast needs a website is organic reach. Okay, organic reach is so stinking important, especially with, and I don't know about your experience, but I'll just give you Instagram. So whenever I post something on Instagram, I don't get as much engagement as I have in the last 6 months unless I put out a reel. And there was a point in time, we have episodes like where we talked about Instagram reels, where I was doing them on a very regular basis and I was getting like all these views and all this like traffic to my page. But y'all, reels aren't something that you can just sit down and create in like 2 seconds and be done with it. Whenever I do it, I like to kind of plan it out and edit it a little bit and add some text and make it fun and fancy and all the things. So I can't really do a reel every single day. And I've just noticed that my reach isn't as great on Instagram as it once was. So we've talked about this before. You cannot always rely on social media to do your promotion and marketing for you. But what happens is when you have a website where you are consistently using keywords, and we're going to talk about SEO and keywords in a second, but when you're consistently putting out content that is targeted to your specific audience, that organic reach is going to be so much more than if you didn't have that. Okay, this is very important because I have definitely played around with promoting and advertising on Facebook and Instagram, but I don't always pay for this. Like, it's not something that's consistently in my budget. I do it during specific promotions, but that SEO, that organic reach, it's working all the time. It is working all the time. And I actually, in the next episode, I'm going to share with you my Google Analytics and the actual reach that my podcast website has on a regular basis. I'm going to share with you from whenever I first started, like whenever I pivoted to teaching podcasting and I rebranded the podcast to what it is today. And the numbers are good. They're pretty shocking. They're pretty crazy of how much it was from the beginning to where it is now. And I can tell you, the sooner you get started with your website, the better. So I know it may sound like this big, robust, overwhelming thing if you've never done a website before. But do you remember who I was talking about? That stay-at-home mom at the beginning of this episode where she had no idea what she was doing. Like, she was hoping she just didn't break the internet. That was me. And now it's no big thing to create show notes and put them up on the website, to create a sales page, to create something of importance that will make my listeners, that's you, that is you, I want you to go to my show notes. If you've found yourself saying, yeah, I've gone to Krystal's show notes. I've watched a video there before. We're going to talk about videos in the next episode too. But I think it's so important to have a place to send your people, Okay, but I'm getting ahead of myself. We're going to talk about that too. But I want to go back to organic reach and SEO. So we have episodes. If you're like, Krystal, what the heck is SEO? What are these keywords you speak of? We have 3 episodes of this podcast that are dedicated to creating awesome show notes, to SEO keywords, and to understanding how to rank higher in Google with your keywords. So I'm going to link to those in the show notes, krystalprofit.com/episode 263. Go check those out. Go listen to those. If SEO is something that you're like, I've heard this term, it's search engine optimization. That's what that stands for. If you've heard this term many times and you're like, yeah, that's just for bloggers, or that's just for someone else who has a website, I don't understand what that means, you need to go listen to these episodes, because this is the thing that I waited. I waited way too long to really get a true understanding of what keywords were and how to use them and why they really mattered. Like, I waited too long. Like, I want you to learn from my mistakes. Please, please, please Don't wait so long to understand how keywords and this SEO organic reach can really work in your favor, especially if you're like, I don't know that I'm going to have a budget to invest in ads for anytime soon. I don't know that I'm going to be able to promote on Google or YouTube anytime soon. Well, then you want to make sure that your SEO game is strong. You want to make sure that you are reaching people in Google organically. Okay. Whew, man, I felt like that was a rant. Hang on, let me take a breath. Okay. Now, the other point that I wanted to make, and the reason why podcast websites are so important, is because it gives you the opportunity to take the next step with your audience. This is a question that I get often, is like, well, how do you connect with your audience? You're just talking into a microphone, but they're just listening whenever they listen, right? It's that asynchronous, like, hey, I can upload this whenever, and then someone can listen to it today, 5 days from now, 10 years from now, right? People can listen to it whenever they want. So how do I actually engage with my people? Well, you have a website. You have a place to send them. This is why I always tell you about my show notes, because if you want to learn more about what I'm doing, you can go to the show notes. And then if you're there and you're clicking around, you're like, oh, hey, I can go click on the about page. I can learn more about Krystal. Or, oh, hey, she has this really cool YouTube video that I didn't know was there. Now I can go watch it. She has this incredible product. She has this awesome program. She has all these other extra resources that I may not have known about had I not gone to the website. So if you are looking to make that deeper connection with your audience, having a website will help you do that, not relying just on social media, not relying on just some other platform that you don't have control over, right? Like, I really want this point to hit home because it's so important to be able to make that connection with your audience without having to depend on an algorithm. Man, I just feel like I'm ranty today. We are getting some rants out. Woo, let me get off my soapbox for a second. Okay. So taking the next step with your audience could look like selling your products and services. I already told you earlier about creating sales pages. Like, y'all, I write all of my sales pages. I've had one instance where I had someone help me with a sales page, and I had someone tell me, they were like, that doesn't sound like you. I could tell immediately once I started reading it that it did not sound like your voice. It didn't sound like how you would actually be talking to me and telling me about this thing. And that was really important for me to take that feedback and say, okay, like, how can I actually make this better? So selling your products and services on your website is just another way to connect with your audience. Y'all are always asking me, how can I monetize? How can I make money with my podcast? Well, if you have a website, that's kind of laying the foundation for you connecting with your audience to sell them something, whether it's a book, whether it's a digital course, whether it's a service, a membership, whatever it is that you're selling. If you don't have anywhere to send them, how are they going to know where to go? Okay, so I think that it's really important that a podcast website can do this for you. And then another thing is list building. Y'all, we've talked about list building on here. I'm gonna link to some other really cool resources for building your email list with a podcast, like how you can create your first lead magnets, how to grow an email list with a podcast. I have so many episodes and videos on this already, but if you don't have a website, it's still doable, right? You can have an email service provider like ConvertKit, like MailChimp, like Flowdesk. Like, there's a lot of these different resources out there that you don't necessarily have to have a website, but I believe it makes it easier for you to just figure it out now, right? Because this is what you're so scared of. You're like, creating a website, it just sounds hard. It sounds hard. Well, let me tell you, in 2014, 2015, YouTube was not as robust as it is today, okay? And it was not filled with as many experts as there are today. And I can tell you that everything has gotten a lot better, a lot better. So if you can Google it, if you can YouTube it, I promise you, you can figure out how to create a podcast website that can work to your advantage, and having the ability to house your lead magnets, to create landing pages. Like, I'll give you an example. I use WordPress and ConvertKit to help me build my email list. And what's cool is, you know, some people will say, well, I don't want those long, ugly URLs that ConvertKit provides for you. This is what I'm talking about. You can do everything in ConvertKit, but you may have this long, ugly URL and you're like, oh, I got to go create a bit.ly to make it shorter. I got to do something else. Well, what I can do with having my WordPress site and ConvertKit connected together, I can create it crystalprofit.com/whatever I want it to be, because they're connected together. So even though you're going to a URL that's part of my website, you're actually like ConvertKit and WordPress are just talking to one another and you're going to like the same place. I know this might sound a little technical, but at the end of the day, it's actually making your life easier because you're using these platforms cohesively as they were meant to be used. And it makes building your email list so much easier, so much easier. And that's just another way for you to create those deeper connections with your audience. If you're not on my email list, you need to get on there. You need to get on there because every single Friday, I send weekly emails to my list, and sometimes they're just crazy stories. Sometimes they're experiences that I've had, and sometimes I share stuff there that I do not share anywhere else. Like, I won't post about it on social media, and if I do talk about it, it's a totally different version of what I actually share. Like, I go a lot deeper in my emails because those are my love letters to my audience. That's really the whole intent of creating my weekly newsletters to y'all. It's, I want you to feel like you know me. I want you to have this deeper connection, and having a podcast website just makes building my email list so much easier. So we'll wrap up real fast with, why does your podcast need a website? So first, we talked about organic reach, taking advantage of SEO and keywords to really help your podcast stand out and to get it in front of an organic audience. I mean, you're spending less money on ads. You're spending no money on ads whenever you are strategically thinking about SEO and keywords. So make sure you go listen to those podcast episodes we talked about. And then number two, you're taking the next step with your audience. Okay, whether that's selling your products and services, your physical products, your digital products, your membership, whatever it is, you can do that if you have a website. And then the second part of that is building your email list, having a place to house your lead magnets, like whatever, if you have a freebie, if you have a PDF, like whatever that is, having the ability to put that organically into your website, I believe it makes everything a lot easier. Then the last thing I want to tell you is your calls to action are everything. So if you are going to have a podcast website, make sure you have easy to say, easy to read, easy to remember URLs. And what I mean by that is, let's take the show notes for this episode, for example, crystalprofit.com/episode263. Now, if you've listened to this podcast enough, you know that that call to action doesn't change. It's always crystalprofit.com/episode, whatever the number is. This is just how it works. So if I tell you, you hear somewhere that I say, hey, go check out episode 84, then you just know, oh, that's crystalprofit.com/episode84. You just know that. And it's something that I have trained my audience to know because I say it every single episode. Every episode, I give you the same call to action. It's just a slightly different number. It's the episode number every single time. And I do that intentionally. So you always know where to find the resources that I mention in a specific episode. So your calls to action are everything when you're creating your podcast website. Okay, so that's the first version, like part one of this podcast website series. If you have any questions, please reach out in our Facebook group. There's going to be a link in the show notes to our Facebook group. If you've never joined us, we would love to have you. And like I said, the BC Stack 2021 promotion is going on right now. It is from June 13th through June 18th. 2021. So if you're listening to this at a later date and you click the link in the show notes, then you're probably going to go like, say, hey, sorry, you missed out. But I want to remind you, this product is only $47 and it gives you 65 plus expert products. That means that the people who it's Dan and Rachel, they are the co-founders of BC Stack. And they have gathered so many experts across the online marketing, digital marketing space and said, hey, would you contribute a product to this bundle? And then we're going to give it to all these people for $47. Y'all, I'm telling you, the product that I created, it's how to create a podcast website listeners actually want to visit, is at least worth the $97. It is, because I have taken time to create an incredible presentation. It's going to be live, by the way. You don't have to attend live. There's going to be a replay, but it's going to be a live presentation where I'm going to walk you through lessons that I have learned in having a podcast website. So if this is something that's like, it's on your bucket list and you're like, Krystal, this has been on my to-do list. It's been something I've been meaning to do. I'm actually going to share with you some simple ways that you can create a website. If you're just like, I'm just not to the WordPress, like that sounds really intimidating. I actually have some workarounds that you can use to still create a podcast website that looks legit. It looks really nice without a lot of the complicated technical things. So you can learn more by going to krystalprofit.com/BCStack21. And I'm gonna have a link in the show notes. So make sure you go check those out. But that's all I have for you today. So if this is your first time joining us, this was such a fun episode for you to join us. I hope that you hit the follow button wherever you're listening to this. Take a screenshot and tell me what you thought about today's episode. I would love to hear it. Tag me on Instagram and say, this was my number one takeaway. And if you haven't already, I would so appreciate you leaving us a rating and a review telling us what you thought about today's podcast episode. But that's all I have for you. So as always, remember, keep it up. We all have to start somewhere. Hey, Profit Podcast listeners. Thanks for sticking around to a little bit after the episode to hear this special message, because I want to hear from you. We are starting a new segment called Fan Mail Shoutouts, and I want to hear from you, and I want to hear your questions. What do you want to know? What questions have you been dying to ask me? So here's how to make this happen. Go to the app where you're listening to this podcast right now. Go there. I'll wait a second. Okay. Now, once you're there, you're going to see a hyperlink at the top of the episode description that says, send Krystal a text message. And that's all I want you to do. Send me a text. It could be casual, informal. It could be totally anonymous. Or if you want, you can include your name and the name of your podcast or content wherever you are creating, and I will give you a special shout out in an upcoming episode. So again, go to the show notes for where you're listening to this episode right now, and it will say, send Krystal a text message. And I cannot wait to hear from you and give you a shout out in an upcoming segment of Fan Mail Shoutouts.